Welcome, everyone, to another edition of Play It Through, and on this edition, it's Godzilla Monster of Monsters, brought to us by Toho. The first Godzilla game features a large variety of various kaiju from the Godzilla and the Toho worlds, though several of the creatures that end up appearing actually don't even appear in any actual Godzilla movie, and the plot basically has Godzilla traveling from planet to planet, eventually making it to the mysterious planet X, with the final boss of the game being King Ghidorah. Every planet that we travel to adds a new main kaiju for us to fight, and we still have to then refight all the other kaiju that we've been battling from the first planet onwards. When we start the game, we'll get our opening story before we jump into the first level. After the incredibly slow-moving text of the opening cutscene, we then make it to planet Earth. There is basically a grid-like system with four or so different types of levels for us to tackle in Godzilla Monster of Monsters. These are like rocky areas, jungle areas, ship levels, and then there's a special levels like the hyperspace levels they're called, which usually feature another big boss-like creature for us to get past, though they don't work like the same as the giant kaiju monsters we'll be fighting throughout. You have two playable characters in Godzilla and Mothra, with Mothra being my personal favorite of all the Godzilla monsters. Unfortunately, though, Mothra isn't extremely useful. She doesn't have the best attacks, and the worst thing about this game is the knockback that happens to both Godzilla and Mothra, and Mothra's knockback is extremely more annoying than Godzilla's knockback. For the first level, Earth, I'm going to play a bit as Godzilla and Mothra and get them both through the planet of Earth. Once I make it to the later planets, I'm going to start off by having Mothra die, and this will allow me to speed things up and get through the level a lot quicker with only having to control Godzilla. This leaves me more vulnerable because once one monster dies, you can still control the other one, and as long as one makes it to the next planet, you'll be able to continue without getting a game over. This is an example of one of those hyperspace screens that I'm going by real quick. You can actually bypass some enemies in the game by using the atomic breath of Godzilla, but anyway, that's actually Matango, who was another one of the many Toho kaiju monsters and had their own movie. It is one of those things where it's just weird to see so many different references, and it's something that I obviously appreciate a lot more now than when I was a kid, when I wasn't as familiar with Toho and Godzilla. I was actually very limited in my knowledge until I started watching a lot of the movies as they were aired on like the likes of TNT back in the day, and then actually started collecting the VHS tapes from my local video store. Every week I would go there with my dad and pretty much beg him to buy me whatever next Godzilla movie until eventually I ran out of new ones to actually buy. When moving along the grid-like map, eventually you'll run into the monsters to fight, and then you'll have to do battle with them. You can't just bypass them and kind of get around them. If they're connected to you on the hexagonal map, you then have to do battle with them before you'll be able to continue. Don't worry, I'll have plenty of time to talk through strategies of the various monsters as we're going through, as we start off with only two available to us on the planet of Earth, which is Gazora and Mogra. Now, Gazora was from the movie known as, like, Space Amoeba, which was its own kind of thing. Once again, not an actual main Godzilla movie. And as, like I said, a couple of the monsters that we end up battling didn't even make any appearances in the main Godzilla films. Also, right here, as you'll see that I'm battling that sea dragon-like creature, is Manda, which ends up making many appearances throughout the course of this game as a normal enemy, but maybe it's not supposed to be exactly Manda, maybe like Manda, but still, it's a pretty obvious reference there. One of my favorite of the Godzilla kaijus to fight in this game is Mogra, because he's so easy to kind of get stuck and be able to just keep wailing on with Godzilla's tail. Most of the fights in this game are easily won by just using Godzilla's tail whip, so that's something you're going to see almost throughout the entire run. It's just consistently me using that tail whip. Mogra is actually from the movie The Mysterions and did appear in one Godzilla film, I think it was only one, as well as he has appeared in a bunch of the Godzilla video games, though. He does consistently make appearances in not only this game, but several other Godzilla games over the years. But either way, once you've defeated both of the kaijus on this planet, or once you've defeated all of them on whatever planet you're on, you still have to complete the rest of the map. You have to basically move Godzilla across the hexagonal map to the main base, and then when you make it there, you'll then be able to teleport to the next planet. There is one key thing that is really, really stupid about this game, and why I ended up destroying Mothra right at the very beginning, instead of after I've gotten Godzilla all the way through the map, and that's because if Godzilla transports to the next planet, and I then die as Mothra, it's game over. Even though Godzilla made it onto the next planet, if I lose Mothra after Godzilla's already been teleported or whatever, it's a game over, which is just something extremely dumb. So that's why we always end up, for the most part, destroying Mothra at the very beginning of the next planet. Now, when you're first playing, you may end up playing it and actually like Mothra and be able to figure out some strategies that I've been unfortunately unable to do so. After putting lots and lots of hours into this game using Mothra, trying to come up with really useful strats and try to make it, you know, tangible to actually control Mothra through the entire run of the game, I just eventually got too frustrated. The knockback she ends up getting is just so devastating that it got so frustrating, so unbelievably frustrating. I cannot emphasize that enough, that I just was like, you know what, I'm just using Godzilla from here on out. As we make it to the end here, we're then going to move Godzilla now to the next planet. When you make it there, it says move him to the next field. He'll then disappear from the map. Now we still have to move Mothra and control her through the map. Now Mothra gets the ability to move more spaces than Godzilla on a given turn. That's one of the benefits she has. The problem is, every time you move through a hexagonal spot, as you've noticed, you still have to complete every screen that you move through on the hexagonal map. So Mothra at times can do up to 4 levels in a row, which is another reason why it became frustrating. So sure, Mothra can move quicker through many of the maps, plus she can fly, so that allows her to kind of go over a lot of the enemies. Some enemies easier to maneuver around than others, that is for sure, but that's definitely a benefit. The real hassle came down not only to some of the more tight areas where she would just get constantly knocked back, but also her move. Being dropping down the feathers from her wings with her main attack, and then also being able to blast enemies straight out with a projectile, just wasn't tangible to use enough to be able to take down most of the kaiju in the game. So that's one of the reasons why I just ended up skipping Mothra for the most part. And something that I've noticed in some other people's strategies that have actually played this game enough to get good enough at it, which there isn't many. This is a game that for many years I've slowly worked on and been wanting to do for a play-it-through video, but it's not an easy game. It's also a very long and repetitive game because of how many times you have to fight the same kaiju over and over again, and you go through a lot of planets. You start off on planet Earth, but then you're going to Mars, Jupiter, Saturn, Uranus, Pluto, Neptune, and then finally planet X. And like I said, every planet you make it to adds another one of the monsters for you to fight, along with all the other ones that you've already fought before. So every single time you're going to be doing the same fights. Now, thankfully, on a few larger scale maps, and there is a couple of larger ones, in fact, the largest one I think in the game is Pluto, which makes, of course, no sense. I don't know if that was done as a joke, but either way, Pluto allows you a little bit more maneuverability because of how many spaces are on the hexagonal map, and this will actually allow you to kind of skip a couple of fights here and there. You don't have to defeat all the kaiju and then move on. Your goal is just to make it to that home base or enemy base spot and then teleport to the next planet. So if you don't have to defeat all the kaiju on each one, the better. One thing you've probably already noticed, as we're now going to move on to the second planet of the game, or World 2, Mars here, which is the same ordeal as we just dealt with, except now that we have a new monster thrown into the mix, which is Varan. Now, from this point on, since I will be defeating Mothra at the beginning of each of the levels, I will show the beginning of that level and then kind of skip ahead until when after Mothra has been defeated. After Mothra's demise, we then get to see one of the monsters on the other side get to move around the board. Now, for the enemy's turn, they only move one monster at a time, which I appreciate mostly because you don't have to then spend so much time watching so many animations of the characters moving along the hexagonal chess-like board. You can just see the one and then get right back to being able to control your characters and continuing on. As far as normal enemies go in the game, Godzilla has two attacks, punch and a kick. If he ducks and kicks, he'll be able to do the tail whip. If he ducks and punches, he kind of stands up and just starts doing his claw punch attack. And then when pressing start, you do your special move, which is, of course, is monitored by the power meter at the top of the screen, your health being directly below that. The atomic breath destroys most enemies right in front of you, damages kaiju pretty well as long as you're able to make contact with them with it. As well as you will get more life and more power to continue to use the atomic breath by leveling up. And you level up by defeating monsters and earning more points, score, and stuff. And you will slowly but surely start to level up. Now, both Mothra and Godzilla have separate leveling up meters. So technically you would want to level them up evenly, but if you level up just Godzilla, by the time you make it to the very end, you should have almost no problems getting through. There is a couple of spots here and there can still be tricky. A couple of the kaiju in particular are a lot harder to kind of manage than others. But for the most part, once you continue to use Godzilla and level him up, the game definitely gets easier, I think, the farther you get in for the most part. Especially once you get a solid strat on most of the monsters. The small stages like this, where you're dealing with the Matango-like creature, is easily one of my favorites. Another one because I can just skip on by it, use the atomic breath when I get near, and kind of just skip past. One of the things that makes this game a chore in a lot of regards is just because of so many of these areas that you're going to be going through that have very similar looks and designs to them. It's also very annoying sometimes with certain enemy types, like the volcanoes in the background during this section. You walk into, even though they're in the background, you have to actually attack like the top of them and hit like the invisible top of the volcano to get it to stop spewing and then be able to actually attack it. Now, because of the path I ended up taking, I can move right here, which I will end up battling Varan at the end. Now, Varan first appeared in his own movie, was also in Destroy All Monsters, but other than that, really doesn't make many overall appearances or is a big part of it. And so it's one of the kind of more obscure of the creatures that ends up being a part of this game. The ducking move of Godzilla actually allows you, I think, to move quicker. Something I noticed while ducking is I seem to move a little bit quicker. That may just be my own eyes playing a trick on me as far as the movement goes. And that allows me to kind of go under some enemies while battling them. I don't have to kill everything if I'm able to kind of slowly sneak underneath of them. Also, the tail whip does a lot of damage to a lot of the other enemies too, so even if I have to attack a few while ducking sometimes, I'm able to at least still hit them. Now, health in general in the game is pretty plentiful, but there are some times where health may get low, especially early on until we level up a bit, so you do sometimes have to be a bit cautious when it comes to attacking the enemies. The good thing is, though, there are usually bunches of enemies right in a row a lot of times that have health that they will end up dropping, so you can quickly grab it. The only issue sometimes with that is it can be difficult at moments to actually be able to catch up with the health as it tries to kind of get away from you once it ends up spawning from an enemy that you ended up defeating. At any point, if you end up starting to get ganged up on, always have the Atomic Breath ready so that you'll be able to use it. Now, for Varen is another pretty easy fight. We're going to use Atomic Breath when we can, and for the most part, use the Tail Whip. Now, you can't hit Varen when you're right next to them. So, like, if he's right next to you and you're doing the Tail Whip, you'll end up missing your attack. But you, a lot of times, can kind of get him stuck in a nice little pattern, get him a little bit away from you, and you'll be able to keep hitting him. For the most part, as long as you're seeing him flash and his health go down, then obviously you know your attacks are doing damage. At any point, if you're able to get your Atomic Breath back built up, then stand up and deliver that a hit, and then immediately go right down into the crouching animation again. The crouching animation, not only does this allow us to do that Tail Whip, a lot of enemy attacks won't knock us back while we're ducking. Most times when we're standing and trying to go like head-on with enemies, they'll end up hitting us and knocking us back. But if you're ducking, not all the moves will knock you back. Now, Gazora here, again, is one of the toughest to hit. Because of the jumping pattern that he always is doing, it can be difficult to hit him with the Atomic Breath when we do get the hits. And, like a lot of bosses can, they gangs up on you in the corners like this, and not allowing me to just sneak out and hit him. As far as getting out of the corners, it's very tricky. Usually I mash up and down, like trying to do jump or ducking, and consistently hit the attack buttons as well in order to just try to force him to back a little bit away from me so that I'll be able to kind of knock him just a bit back so I can actually deliver some attacks again. Early on, it's dangerous more so because your health can be drained pretty fast. Once you get a little bit farther in, it's a lot harder for those kind of gang up attacks to actually do enough significant damage to threaten Godzilla's health, but it's still, like I said, extremely annoying. There's nothing more annoying than being like, oh my god, I'm stuck in a corner. I know I'm trying to attack this thing, but there's just no way that I'm able to actually hit it. It's so frustrating. It's so impossible to describe how frustrating it can honestly get unless you try out the game for yourself. That is for sure. Besides the volcanoes in the background, these like pillars that kind of come up are another extreme nuisance that you have to deal with quite a lot. There's a couple of enemy styles like this that you have to consistently deal with. Like I said, if at all possible, use Atomic Breath when you can, though some enemies like these pillars, your Atomic Breath, while it works on them, of course, you won't be able to just glide on past them like you can some of the other types of enemies. I really do wish, though, there was a little bit more variety with the enemy types and just the levels, basically, that we're going to have to do. You're going to see this type of level, this one I'm doing right here, with the walls coming in, the types of, like, guns on the machine spaceship itself. You will probably see, no joke, at least 20-25 of this almost exact level throughout the course of this playthrough, which... that is telling enough of just why this game isn't as finely remembered as it could have been, because it's such a cool concept. And then with factoring in the just okay combat, which thankfully years later I learned how to kind of get better at by manipulating a lot of the enemy AI, like for example Megara here, where I can just kind of duck down and use my Tail Whip, and a lot of times just get him completely stuck. He won't even move to attack. Even if he does, it's very easy to then kind of get him right back into the same pattern and be able to take him out that way. Thankfully, this is the last area we have to do here on Mars, and then we'll be able to move on to the third planet of the game, which is Jupiter. Though, of course, like I said, you'll be seeing this type of stage quite a bit. Like I said, I've been a big Godzilla fan for most of my life, but Godzilla, the original Godzilla film, is actually one of the later ones I ended up seeing. The first of the Godzilla movies I actually ever saw was King Kong vs. Godzilla. I remember seeing it. I don't know if it was on television or if I saw my VHS copy first. That, unfortunately, I don't remember, though I know King Kong vs. Godzilla was one of the first VHS tapes that I ended up buying, and then from that point, like I said, I just got completely, like, addicted to it, buying up, like, Mothra vs. Godzilla, which is why I absolutely love Mothra. That got me to buy Mothra, the actual original version of that movie, and then pretty much just anything I could get a hold of. I know some of the ones that were released in the 80s were another group of ones I was able to get, such as Godzilla vs. Biollante, and then Return of Godzilla, or known as Godzilla 1984. The North American, the U.S. released version of it was the one I ended up seeing, of course, first. And, like many, unfortunately, was disappointed that there wasn't a lot of Godzilla movies for, like, the 90s and such, and that was not because they didn't exist, but because they just weren't released. At least not easily released in North America. So it was one of those things where, like, a few years later, I want to say when I got into high school, was when I kind of got back into Godzilla, and this is where I was able to find, like, the other movies I hadn't seen yet, and was kind of, like, really blown away at just kind of the major difference of, like, the 90s era of Godzilla, just, you know, because of special effect improvements and just everything with it, and made me fall in love with Godzilla and the Toho monsters even more so than I already had. While there are plenty of things I'm a fan of and, like, really big into the fandom of, out of everything with, like, Japan in general, like, outside of, like, the really niche stuff like Godzilla, like, I never got into, like, the Super Sentai stuff, you know, which is, of course, Power Rangers is part of that whole series and all that stuff. I have plenty of fans that I know are into it all, so I apologize for messing up anything with that, but, like, it's one of those things where it's like, I've never been able to get into that. I've even, over the years, gotten out a bit of, like, anime in general, mostly just because of time, not having enough time to really watch long-running anime series anymore. But Godzilla, an interest in Godzilla, is something that I've always kept and enjoy geeking out about when I get the opportunity to do so, and will eventually get to see, like, everything that's been released. I saw got the North American, of course, 2014 Legendary Pictures Godzilla in theaters, though I haven't, at the recording of this, seen the newest Shin Godzilla yet, and I'm looking forward to the new series and some of the new stuff that they're doing. And besides Mothra, some of my other favorite of the kaiju that are in the series, I like a lot of the more obscure ones, but actually making into the series. Another one of my personal favorites has always been King Caesar, because I've always thought King Caesar had a cool design, and then factoring that song, having his own theme, was one of the coolest things, even though he never really has had an opportunity to show much. I mean, he showed up in First Godzilla vs. Mechagodzilla, and then, like, made one later appearance in Final Wars, and then outside of that has, like, not been in anything other than a couple of, like, the video games. I know the Godzilla Unleashed on the Nintendo Wii or whatever, he was a playable character in that, but for the most part, King Caesar doesn't get a lot of love, so he's another one of my favorites of the Godzilla world and the Godzilla Toho monsters. A couple of the other ones that I've always really liked, I've always liked Rodan, and another kind of obscure one in Ghibarah. Ghibarah is another one that I liked. I think the combination of, like, the Godzilla-esque lizard body but had, like, the cat type head is probably why I like Ghibarah. But those are probably my favorites, are all the Mothra, King Caesar, Rodan, and Ghibarah are definitely some of my favorites. Though I do love the standards, you know, the Mechagodzillas, your King Ghidorah especially, and the really, like, kind of off-the-wall versions of Gigan. Just that body buzzsaw is absolutely insane, and so I've always appreciate and love Gigan as well, but yeah, those are some of my favorite Toho monsters. Be sure, of course, to let me know, you probably will in the comments, like, what are your favorite of the Toho monsters and the universe, if you're a big fan of the series. And, like, when did you get into it? Like, was it when you were a kid? How were you able to see the movies? Did you watch them on TV when they would rarely show up? Or did you end up buying the VHS tapes like I did at my local, it was a store, Saturday Matinee. Was the video store where I would actually go and buy. They had a video game section as well as, like, music and As well as, of course, the VHSs, of course, you know, movies at the time. And so that's where I would look for the video games, usually see if there was anything cheap for video games I could convince my dad to get me. And at the same time, we'd immediately go, and they had, like, the foreign, I want to say it was a foreign section was where the Godzilla films were, which makes sense. And they, of course, were all the English dubbed versions. I didn't see a Godzilla movie with subtitles until many, many years later. So all the funny things, of course, of the mess of lip syncing and just the whole English dubs, especially the early Godzilla movies, is still absolutely hilarious to this day. But yeah, that's how I kind of first saw them, and for that reason I became a fan. Probably because I was a kid is what helped that too, because as a kid I didn't care that the lip syncing was off really, or that, you know, it wasn't the best dubbed, you know, thing ever. I thought the monsters were cool, and I was willing to sit there through all the dialogue sequences and a lot of story a lot of times before we finally would get to the monsters. But it was always, you know, worth the payoff most of the time. There are a handful of Toho monsters that I'm not a huge fan of, one of which actually makes it into this, which I've always gone back and forth of joking that I love it, but at the same time I can't stand it, and that is Hedera, or the Smog Monster. That was an early one I ended up seeing, and it's always, this was like, what the heck. And then the other big one was in North America, it was known as Godzilla versus the Sea Monster, but is known as Ebera, Horror of the Deep, or whatever, the Japanese version. But I saw it originally as Godzilla versus the Sea Monster when it was released on VHS. I will say I do like the dark blue color scheme of, like, this particular style of planet level. I think that looks really cool with the sprite work and everything. And here we go with Gazora once again, trying to do my jump and kicks. The punches come out a little bit faster if you can mash the attack button a bit. Though shorter range than the kick, but works pretty well on Gazora in particular. But of course I'm always mostly just combating to knock him away and then try to get my atomic breath off so that I'm able to take out Gazora and you know, move on. I don't even know at this point how many times I fought Gazora. When you take all the fights in this run alone, combined with every practice run and every run I did as a kid and everything else, like how many times I've actually fought and beaten Gazora. I do like it also in this game where monsters go right into another, like, right into a battle. Like, once I finish a fight with one, the next one just moves right in, and I go right into the next battle. Not only because that kind of speed things along a little bit, but I think that's kind of a cool concept. It's like Godzilla Battle Royal. One monster comes in, he gets rid of the one, and then boom, here comes the next one. He just immediately goes into that fight and takes out that one. So I always like it, though. Varin, not very interesting, of course. Most of the time I'm going to spend ducking in the corner here and just delivering those hits. As you can see, even though Varin hits me a bit here and there, like, the amount of health it's taken away is just so minimal. It barely does a scratch to me overall. So now we're going to get the battle of the Smog Monster for the first time in this run, which can deal a bit of damage. Hedera can actually do a little bit. Also, like always, if I pronounce any of the names differently from the way you've pronounced them, it's just, this is the way I've always said them, a lot of them. Sometimes I'll even change my pronunciation of them as I said them, but you guys know which of the creatures and stuff I am talking about, and that's always my intent, is just so you know what I'm talking about. I don't say it so outrageously that you have no idea what I'm referring to when I say it, so I'm not intentionally trying to upset anybody by the way I pronounce some of the monsters' names or any of the other Japanese terms I use in this video or any video that I end up doing, any of the games I end up doing runs of. Usually a lot of older stuff I've said one way, I've always said it, and it's hard to kind of get out of that habit, especially when doing commentary and stuff where you're talking for a long period of time. As well as just that's just the way I read the thing, and as long as you know what I'm talking about, that's the most important thing. Apparently this tower does not want to die for me here, but finally does, and here we go. There it is. There's Hedera, the Smog Monster. Atomic Breath works well, and then go right into, of course, the ducking sweep. If you stand in a little bit of a distance from him, you can keep hitting the tail whip, and his arms extensions here won't end up hitting Godzilla. They can do some good damage. You also can get hurt by the projectiles, but by ducking, the projectiles don't knock Godzilla back. That is the key to making sure that I can stay close to him and keep delivering consistent hits, though sometimes he'll move a little bit closer to us and we'll have to move away, though usually at that point I'm able to get another charge up of the atomic breath and can deliver that. Eventually he will drop. So another relatively easy fight, though I didn't take out all his health, something that happens in the game rarely. But if you're fighting a monster and you defeat most of their health down to like one bar left or so, they sometimes at the end of the fight, instead of going right back into another fight, they will end up fleeing and just go to the next map altogether. Now, when they go to the next map, they get their full health back just like they normally would anyway. So it honestly is just, it helps you more than anything, though you don't get the points for defeating them, I guess. I guess that's the only negative if the monster ends up fleeing from you. It's always an annoyance in this game when you run out of time in the fights, because you have a limited time once the battle begins for you to defeat them. But usually, the monsters aren't going to be able to move away from you. They're coming towards you anyway. So you usually get right back into the battle, and yeah, they may recover a tiny bit of health, but it's really not much health they end up getting back. It's very minimal. It's not like they get their full health back once the timer ends up running out. And that way you can usually just finish him off. Maybe a couple more hits are needed, but it's, while annoying and kind of useless to have that kind of time limit type thing, it really isn't anything that bad to deal with. But finally, we make it to the end. We have one more screen to go, and we'll be able to move on to the next planet. Though this screen, as you can see, is pretty much identical to the one I just did. The one enemy in the entire game that actually poses a legitimate threat to ending your game, and at a moment's notice pretty much can, is, you'll notice from time to time, the flashing, at the front of them is like the bulb-like thing, like this guy right here with that thruster rocket thing. I don't know if it's a ship or creature, whatever the heck that thing is. It kind of comes towards you, and then what you'll need to do is jump while it's away from you, and you can kind of force its pattern to kind of go away, trying to come towards you, and usually this way will go over your head. The reason why this creature is deadly is when it runs into you, it hits you every second. Like, there's no invincibility or vulnerable time, and it can just keep nailing you over and over again and drain your health very fast. It is the only creature you always have to be paying attention enough to in the game so that you'll be able to take it out. Now that we've made Saturn, let's move Mothra over and take out Mothra and move on with the level itself. It honestly pains me every time that I have to kill off Mothra in this run, but this is something that just, it helps so immensely. Now this board in general isn't anything really too spectacular. You can kind of get stuck at the very beginning if you waste too much time, wait for the monsters to kind of come towards you, but more than likely, you're going to want to hunt them down, so the map itself really doesn't pose too much of a threat or anything. Now, introduced here is Baragon. Baragon is the new creature introduced on this planet. Baragon would actually first appear in Frankenstein Conquers the World, or Frankenstein vs. Baragon, and it did appear in a couple of the Godzilla movies. Not a ton of them, but a few. I know in Destroy All Monsters, Baragon is in there very briefly, and then also in Giant Monsters All Out Attack, made during the Millennial series, Baragon ends up making a brief appearance. But actually, Baragon's one of the ones in this game that I do like ends up showing up, just because I do like the design overall of Baragon. But the fight against Baragon consistently in this game is one of the more difficult ones. Not an extremely difficult one, but one of the more difficult ones. Other than the change of planets, though, in the introduction, of course, for another kaiju, there isn't any difference as far as the levels themselves that you're going to be taking on. I think very rarely throughout the playing, there is a couple of newer enemies or lesser seen enemies that may make more appearances throughout as far as like the normal little guys that you're dealing with, but it's so minimal that I hardly even noticed if there was things added as I made it past like the first or second planet, as you just kind of see the same things. Like I said, other than that flashing, like, beam light bulb-like looking thing at the front of that one enemy that you can always tell when he's coming, that you have to watch out and make sure that you manipulate and get away from. Other than that, everything else you'll pretty much be able to just run through, use atomic breath, or just punch and kick your way until you're able to make it to the right side of the screen and move on. Here we go with Gazora once again. Good old Gazora. At this point, you probably start to laugh at just how many times I get stuck in the corner against these fights with Gazora. I'm sure somebody has a better strategy at this point for figuring out how to not get stuck in a corner against maybe Gazora or some of the other kaiju in the game. But for me, I've never been able to figure it out. I've tried to manipulate it. I've tried to like get a little bit closer sometimes, a little bit farther away sometimes. But either way, I usually end up getting somewhat stuck into the corner. Because of the way this map is set up, you can sometimes be able to get away from some fights to kind of speed things up a very tiny bit. That's like I said, you can only really do that on a couple of maps in the game because only a few of them are pretty big. A couple of them are actually really small, including one that'll be coming up relatively shortly. And then the final one, Planet X, which is set up intentionally small so that you have to fight every creature in the game, every kaiju in the game, before you'll be able to, you know, complete the game and beat it after beating King Ghidorah. Which is disappointing for Ghidorah fans, because Ghidorah only appears in the one level because of that. I mean, thankfully, and it makes sense for him to be the final boss, but at the same time, because of that, you only see him one time. After going through those couple of levels, we make it to Varin once again. Gonna blast him with that atomic breath and immediately go into my ducking animation. If he's able to push me around a little bit, I have to go back to the wall but can still keep hitting him. Or if he backtracks, I can chase him down while sliding on the ducking animation and be able to still deliver those tail swipes. By now, you probably start to get used to the whole kind of tail swiping strategy as far as the way they kind of defeat most of the kaiju in the game, and we're able to easily take him down here with it. Only negative on this map is you do have to go quite a big distance, as you can see. There's a lot of levels that we're going to have to kind of go past in order to eventually make it over there. Though thankfully we have this level right here where we'll be able to easily use the atomic breath and sneak on by for one screen, at least can get done quickly. And then into another screen like this with all of the space equipment and space towers and whatever these things are. One of the more annoying types of screens, because some of the enemies are a bit harder to actually make contact with and you can easily get hit by projectiles and weapon shots, but still pretty easy. There's usually a plethora of health that will get dropped along the way while you're going through this in order to make sure that you're able to sustain that health level with Godzilla. They start to move a little bit closer as the smog monster makes contact with me here, and for Hedera, once again, we're going to hit him with that atomic breath and duck down in front of him and just keep our distance as much as we can so we can try to stay out of the reach of his hands and be able to keep hitting him while he will sometimes use those projectiles to do a little bit of damage, but this usually works as a pretty solid strategy to be able to keep him at bay, hit the atomic breath when necessary, and just slowly drain and get rid of his health. Once back, we're able to move down a couple of spots and make contact with Baragon. So we have two of these screens in a row, unfortunately. But then we'll get to face a new kaiju for the first time in this run of the game. This is a great example right here of what can potentially happen with those one particular enemies. I mentioned that if you're not careful, they can drain your health really fast, and that's exactly pretty much what just happened there. They were able to hit me a lot of times and very quickly take out a large chunk of Godzilla's health, which is obviously extremely annoying. Thankfully, I'm able to kind of get some of my health back as I'm going through the level by picking up some of the health drops from a lot of these other towers, but this is why these kind of stages can be annoying. A little bit later on, when you start getting more bar to your power bar and replenish that quicker, then you can have more atomic breaths at your disposal in order to kind of take these guys out, but that's why they are just so unbelievably obnoxious to kind of deal with sometimes. Once we finally make it through the screen, it's time to battle Baragon. Now, Baragon walks on all fours, appropriate. Sometimes, though, he does stand up in order to kind of hit you with his breath-like attack and be able to hit you that way. But the hardest thing about Baragon is he can sometimes be difficult to hit with the atomic breath, sometimes kind of like missing him because of the ducking and on fours animation, as well as he can like kind of jump at you sometimes and do a pretty good chunk of damage and can get you in that permanent stuck location in the left corner. Not as bad as Gazora, but still pretty obnoxious. Strategy, though, is pretty much like a lot of the monsters in the game, though, gonna use the tail whip a lot of the time and stand up and attack only when I need to hit the breath. Now, unfortunately, I'm not able to take out all his health, so we have the other enemy bearing down on us. Not that it's gonna really be able to do much, but go right now back into that Baragon fight with that little bit of health that he ends up having. Now, because of this fight, and I wasn't unable to beat him in one round, this will allow us to have to deal with the other kaiju here. So, even though Baragon's done, Magra will sneak in, and we still have to deal with him. But this is, once again, just a very simple Magra fight. Hit the atomic breath and duck down and just keep swatting until he drops, and we can try to finish up the planet. Now here, we do have a couple of spaces, so we have to move too close, and we still have to do one more set of levels before we'll then be able to move on to the next planet, but these are simple, the space-like ones, just the cannons coming out, the lightning bolts, and just everything we've already been dealing with. There isn't much more special that can be said strategy-wise or anything like that, though it is the worst. I will say, just from a couple of mistakes I have made in previous runs, where I was like kind of got a little bit too cocky at the end, dying. After already defeating all the kaiju and being like one step away, I did die before from like one of these types of levels, just because I got hit by one of those one ships and got my health completely like destroyed and I was unable to get health back. But that is the worst that could possibly happen because of just having to redo then the entire level during practice runs, or in this case, game over and have to restart from the beginning. Now we move one more space onto the final base spot, which, hey look, it's another one of these style of levels. It's amazing, isn't it? Now the next planet we're going to get to travel to is one of my favorites in the game, and not just because, haha, Uranus, but because it's so small. It's another really kind of compact level. As you can see, all the kaiju immediately, just one screen, and there's not a whole lot of hexagonal spots for us to kind of travel to and move across, not a whole lot of spots. Like always, start off by taking out Mothra first. In this case, on this planet, it actually took me longer to take out Mothra, so during that time, Gazora got an actual chance to move because I took too long killing Mothra off. I kind of just let the controller sit there for a bit. So I had to kill Mothra in two sets of stages. So that's why Gazora was able to move, though it didn't cause a fight yet with him. And then finally now we can take control of Godzilla and actually start working our way. Now the cool thing is we do get a little bit of a different level setup. It's something that we haven't dealt with quite as much. So at least having a nice little change here is very much welcome. Though the fight with Gazora remains largely unchanged, as we're going to be using our atomic breath and the jump punches and kicks, and try to keep Gazora from getting us stuck in that corner, which is just something that inevitably always ends up happening at least once or twice during each encounter against him. But the battle itself, though, does remain pretty much the same as always. Now, without even really moving, we get right into our next fight here against Varin, which, once again, hit that atomic breath and duck down in front of him. Sometimes having to do a little bit of chasing of Varin to keep delivering their tail whips, but for the most part, another pretty easy kaiju fight to deal with. Now we get to move a little bit more, get closer to Hedera here, and have to go through another one of these style levels in order to do so. Though, like I said, thankfully these levels are a little bit different than some of the other ones we've been dealing with, so at least there's that little bit of a change when it comes to these. You can also use your atomic breath during these levels to kind of get through some of the other enemies that are kind of floating around. I find consistently doing the punches allows me to take out a lot of them as they are coming towards me. For Hedera, we're going to hit him with that atomic breath and do the duck in front, trying to stay a little bit away so that, of course, the hands don't hit us, though. If they do push us a little bit away, we can easily reset ourselves in order to get back into a nice position and continuing to deliver tail whips. Now, once again, we don't even get a chance to really move or anything before Mogra ends up coming up, but here we go, another very easy fight, the least threatening now at this point of the kaiju, that is for sure, and our strategy remains the same as always, though sometimes this little fire breath that he gets out will be able to knock you away a bit, so it's a bit tougher in some ways, but the atomic breath can still devastate him, just keep it in those tail whips, a lot of times it's completely freezing him and be able to knock him out. Once back on the world map, move a little bit over, and now we're going to go right into the fight against Gigan. It doesn't matter which of the two, of course, I fight. I'm going to have to fight both of them here. I've never had a time on this planet yet where I didn't have to end up fighting everything. So, Gigan, of course, is the new monster, or new kaiju introduced on this planet, the planet of Uranus, during the course of this game. Though it's funny, because right after this level, we end up going to Pluto, even though we technically should move on to, I guess, Neptune next, but we end up doing Pluto, and then Neptune's actually after that, and Pluto ends up being one of the biggest maps, and kind of the more interesting looking maps of any of the ones located in the game, though of course Pluto is the smallest planet, or is it a planet, or is it still a planet, is it not a planet again, I don't even know, I can't keep up with it at this point. Gigan is definitely a tougher fight, mostly because Gigan has his buzzsaw that he can use against you. Now, strategy is pretty much the same as always, though. Tail Whip is your best friend. You're going to be hitting him with it. You can thankfully see kind of an animation usually when you deliver a hit, though he doesn't flash when you're delivering these hits, so you have to pay a little bit more attention as far as if your hits are actually landing, though the animations usually are a dead giveaway. Atomic Breath is always good, and you just want to make sure you can try to stay away from the buzzsaw if at all possible, though if Gigan does the buzzsaw attack with his body, it can do a lot of damage, especially if you're stuck in the far left corner with him when he does it. It can hurt, so just kind of sometimes up to the mercy of the game as far as that's concerned. I don't kill Gigan right away, though. The time runs out, and then Baragon immediately steps in and swings in. This fight, like I said, is definitely one of the tougher ones just because sometimes it's hard to hit him with the Atomic Breath, as well as Baragon can still get you trapped with his leaping ability, get you stuck in that corner as well. So, a couple of the tougher kaiju to have to deal with. Kind of funny though, neither one of them I'm able to defeat in the time limit, but without even moving, I go right back now into the fight against Gigan, who does a little bit more health now, but he's still very easy to kind of finish off. One Atomic Breath does a lot, and then a couple of Tail Whips, and Gigan drops, and then pretty much going to be the same thing here with Baragon when I rematch him in just a second. Baragon tries to get me nicely stuck in the corner, unfortunately, but still able to get those Atomic Breath off and do a little bit of damage. And then once he's done, now I just have to move one more space forward, and we can make it to the next planet after completing the next stage. No surprise that the last level here is another one of these style of stages, as you can see from the map symbol. And then once we're in, it's pretty much the same thing as always when it comes to this level. Now, next up is Pluto, and like I said, this is pretty much a large map. Now, with Pluto, because of the way things are set up, you can easily kind of maneuver around a bit and skip some fights. Usually at least one or two of the kaiju fights I can end up skipping. Like always, we're going to start off by taking out Mothra. Right after, though, back on the map, usually one to have a chance to move before Gazora ends up moving a little bit closer. And before I'm able to even really move with Godzilla, no sense in kind of moving, just might as well take out Gazora first. I always find it funny, a lot of the monsters, kaijus you end up fighting, they all have their own special moves as well. It would have been kind of cool to see maybe a versus type mode in this game just because of that reason. Every one of them has their own specialty move. But a lot of them waste it as soon as the battle begins before they're able to even hit you, possibly hit you. The AI just immediately ends up using their specialty moves and end up wasting their power bar, which I always find funny. I don't know if this was intentional, but more than likely just bad programming from the AI as far as the monsters were concerned. And of course, just because the map is bigger doesn't mean anything else really is changing, though, as far as levels and such. We start off with the land rocky type stages with the fire phoenix-like creatures and the like. Pretty much at this point, though, you've gotten every type of level. I think there's no other types of stages that we will see throughout the course of the gameplay, so you've kind of been introduced to all the random enemies, as well as all the types of levels you're fighting them on. Though, of course, there is a lot of references here. Even the ships in the background and such are, you know, representative of stuff from the Toho Monster universe. So, you could probably look at everything in the game and probably find some correlation with something from either Godzilla movies or the other Toho Monster movies. I know a lot of the references that are made, but I'm not sure of, like, every single one of the ones and what they end up representing. The battle with Varen is the same as always. I'm gonna duck down and swat him with the tail and try to avoid his little claws. He won't be able to do much damage to us at all, and we'll stand up every once in a while and hit that atomic breath and move on to the next fight. Now for the planet, as far as like the path I take, I usually go the upper path. This allows me to skip a couple of the bottom monsters because by the time they kind of will work their way around, I will be able to already start getting towards the actual final point. Basically, you have to go either up or down all the way around and then kind of come back in to get to the center of the board, which is the location, of course, for the exit for the stage. And it's the only stage like that in the game. Every other one's kind of at an end piece where you either get to the north end or the east end, and then you're able to move on. But for this planet in particular, this one only, you end up having to kind of go around and then into the center spot. Thankfully, here we get another one of these style of levels where we can easily bypass and just use the atomic breath to help us and get right through this level. These stages, or these types of stages, are a bit annoying. There's the totem pole-like guys and the bean sprout-esque enemies that always seem to give me some trouble, though you can use atomic breath to bypass them, which is something I use as often as possible to try to get past them. Now once back on the map, Gigan will come towards me here, so now it's time to battle him. Same strategy as we've done before, we're going to hit that atomic breath and do our duck. The problem with Gigan is though he's a little bit more unpredictable than some of the other ones. His attacks can actually end up hitting you. The buzzsaw on his body, like always, is definitely a threat. Without that flash, of course, it's sometimes difficult to tell when he's able to actually be hit, but you can still kind of pay attention to it. Here's a good example of how the buzzsaw can be devastating. Thankfully, it didn't hit me all that much, but if he gets you in the lower left corner, then does the buzzsaw so you're unable to get past it, and he just hits you over and over again, he can be dangerous in that regard. So that's one of the reasons why you want to try to keep him off the wall as best as possible and avoid that whole buzzsaw attack. Now, I'm unable to move here, but I can just continue right into the next portion of the fight right away. He gains that little bit of health back, but still hit that atomic breath, some tail swipes, and he's dead. Now, see, as you can see, there are the Smog Monster and Baragon and all there on the bottom, along with Mogera. So, because of the path I take, it doesn't really kind of activate them all that well. Now, when you make it to the center portion, depending on how long the fights take against Mechagodzilla, who is the new kaiju that's introduced on this level, if you take more than one time to beat him, sometimes Baragon usually can end up kind of catching up to you, and you may have to fight him as well. But if you're quick about it, you will be able to kind of avoid most of the fights. You only have to do a handful of them overall on this map. And considering the next two that we have, Neptune and then the final Planet X, we will have to battle pretty much everything. Avoiding any fights during Pluto is thankfully a useful endeavor. A lot of the levels on the far right side of this planet are these volcano style of levels, though only real annoyance is the whole kind of like earth or ground or whatever you want to call it that's kind of like coming out at you, like the towers. Those can be a little bit difficult at times, though you can kind of like jump on them or jump over them sometimes, or you can of course use that atomic breath to kind of hit them, but you can't use the breath and go through them, unfortunately. There's also the very annoying volcanoes in the background of these areas that you have to hit in order to kind of walk past. After a couple of those volcano levels in a row, I'm back on the map, but now I have a few more I'm going to have to do, but at least at the end of these two, we will get to fight Mechagodzilla for the first time, so that's always a nice little plus to everything. Mechagodzilla, obviously one of the more popular of the kaijus from Godzilla, and was revived and kind of changed a little bit with multiple different versions of Mechagodzilla over the many years of film, and one of the reasons for that is just because of how, you know, popular that Mechagodzilla has always been. Finally, after a very long trek, it's time to battle Mechagodzilla. Now, Mechagodzilla doesn't duck or anything, just comes straight on at you, but has, of course, a lot of firing power, which is to be expected. kind of punch and kick, and uses a laser beam in order to attack you directly, use the atomic breath and do the duck move in order to hit him. Now with this tail thing, he likes to move a lot. Sometimes he can actually knock you away from him using the firepower that he's able to unleash, which can be pretty deadly hit-wise. It does a little bit of damage, more so than I say other creatures really have done to us for the most part throughout the course of the game, but still a pretty simple overall fight. He has a lot of health though. That's the biggest problem, is it's usually hard to defeat Mechagodzilla on your first encounter with him. It usually takes at least two encounters. You can see how much health he still had left. At this point, as you can see, Baragon's trying to get towards me here, but I can go right back into the Mechagodzilla fight and finish him off here during the second encounter, and then try to work my way towards the center goal. So even with a little bit of pressure here, I'm able to kind of get in, and I'll be able to make it through the area without having to do any more fights against the remaining kaiju here. They're just kind of hanging out. They're like, "Whoa, where's Godzilla? He was supposed to come here. He's here, right?" And they're just kind of looking around, I guess. Just kind of shrugging and eventually go to the next planet like everybody else. I guess eventually they realize, oh, we missed him a little bit. The last few levels of this planet are these style of stages, and yeah, nothing's changed. Pretty much the same type of thing we've been dealing with. And now one more screen of this time the gray background version of the ship, but it's the same ship as we've always dealt with. Once back on the main map, time to head off on to Neptune now. Neptune is smaller than Pluto in this, much more compact, a bit bigger than Uranus, that's for sure. Like always, we're going to start off by taking out Mothra before attempting to go through the level. The dumbest thing, though, about the planet is no new kaiju are introduced here. I don't know if they just ran out of ones to add, if originally in the game, maybe like Earth only had Gezora on it, and then Mars introduced Megara, and then, you know, added new ones as we went through, or, you know, whatever it may be. But for whatever reason, Neptune does not have any new kaiju introduced. And then we get the final one, which is King Ghidorah, which will be introduced at Planet X. So, a bit disappointing, for sure. Especially the very first time I ever made it this far into the game. Because I was like, oh, who's going to be next? You know, what's going to be next? You know, just because you want to see it. And there ended up being nothing. Even if you aren't familiar with it, you know, you're like, okay, well, these have been kind of cool monsters. Maybe something cool will be introduced. Even if you're completely unfamiliar with the whole kind of monsters and Toho and all that stuff. But, yeah, fortunately, they don't end up introducing anything new here on this planet. And because of the way that it's set up, you end up having to do more fights than you did have to do on Pluto, just because it's much more compact. It's easier for the monsters to kind of get towards you. So you still will have to actually do more fights here on the smaller planet here because of that. At the end of this set of levels, I'm battling the Smog Monster. It's been a little bit since we battled good old Ghidorah, and hit that Atomic Breath. Now I'm able to kind of hit two Atomic Breaths at once, because I've reached a high enough level of experience, and it actually regens quicker my power in general, so I'm able to kind of sometimes hit two Atomic Breaths at once, and this will be able to be a nice little addition to our strategies overall as we make it to the last planet of the game and the final battles against the monsters. At least we have a little bit more firepower basically behind our attacks to speed things up a bit. But with their health being as big as it is and everything else, they're still relatively lengthy fights overall. No surprise, without even moving, other monsters immediately magnetize themselves toward us, and we get into the battle against Ghidorah. Same as always, do our little jumping attacks and punches and kicks and whatever we can do to try to keep him off of the left wall, and deliver those atomic breath shots when possible. With our turn again, we'll move one spot closer, but we'll have to battle Mugera after we get to the end of it. It's another one of these space station mechanical type of levels. Now, one thing I haven't talked about really at all is the soundtrack to the game, which actually is really well done. The music overall is something that I still enjoy listening to outside of the game, with some absolutely great tracks. So if you want to, you know, get some new 8-bit music maybe into your, you know, library of old classic music you like to listen to. If you don't have the Godzilla for NES soundtrack in there, I can highly recommend giving it a listen. And there's a good amount of tracks, too, with each of the planets having different songs and such. Mugera. Same fight as normal. He usually gets frozen in shock of just, I guess, seeing such, you know, an awesome creature like Godzilla, and knows he has absolutely no chance against us, and just kind of completely freezes up on us, but doesn't take long before he ends up dropping like normal. Now we're able to move a little bit closer and make it to the next fight. Now, because some of the other creatures haven't really started moving, that I may have a small chance of being able to get past without having to fight all of them here, which doesn't always happen. A lot of times I end up triggering some other ones to end up moving, so that's a little bit of a nice little surprise that I'm able to kind of move the way I have and be able to avoid some battles here. After a couple of the space-style levels in a row, it's now time to battle Gigan again, hitting him with that atomic breath. Now, Gigan, because of just the overall fight, sometimes he can end up lasting more than a single round with me. But either way, deliver those tail swipes and keep him as far to the right as possible just to avoid any hazards when it comes to the buzzsaw. Because of not being able to defeat Gigan right there, that allows Baragon to kind of sneak right in. I guess Varen's going to stay on the opposite side of me, on the other far end of the map, and not come towards me, which I guess is a lucky break for once. Hit Baragon with those atomic breath. As you can see, here's a good example of Baragon getting me stuck. Kind of a weird position for his mouth and all, kind of munching on Godzilla's nether regions there when he gets me in the corner, which isn't necessarily appropriate, but... Whatever you're into, Baragon. Either way, you're going to keep swinging the tail at him in order to keep delivering those hits and try to drain down his health bar. Because of all that munching that Baragon decided to do, I have to go right into another fight against him. Start off by hitting that atomic breath if I can, and watch out for the leaps if I also will be able to. And just keep trying to hit him and finally take down Baragon, then we can get back to fighting Gigan. Now, he's gained a little bit of his health back, as you can see, but still shouldn't be too much of a threat, especially now that we have those two atomic breaths right in a row that drain him all the way down to just two bars. So a couple more swipes with the tail, and Gigan ends up dropping. Now, once back on the main map, move towards Mechagodzilla and initiate that confrontation after doing another one of these space station style of levels. Now, like before with Mechagodzilla, he does have quite a bit of firepower. We now have the ability to do the kind of multiple atomic breaths and all that can keep him a little bit at bay and knock him back a bit and do that ducking animation. Just now keep continuing to swing the tail at him in order to drop it down his health. He may be able to survive more than one round, but sometimes you can get lucky and take him down a single round if you time everything perfectly. But either way, he'll then just go right into the next part of the fight, so even if you're able to get through a single round, he's not done yet, you'll get right back into the battle against him. And even though we're at the exit here, or right at the end, even though we haven't fought Varen yet, there is that chance Varen will still move towards us and battle us once we get through this level, so we may still have to end up taking out all of the creatures in this planet. Thank you. Yep, unfortunately, moving to where we did, Varen is activated and does decide to move at us. So hit him with that breath and immediately go into our whole kind of thing. Pretty easy fight compared to some of the other ones we've already dealt with on this planet. And once he's done, we'll get to move on to Planet X, which is the final planet of the game. So now it's time for the final level, the mysterious Planet X, a very straightforward level with a decent variety, actually, to the types of level landscapes. Like always, we're going to start off by taking out Mothra, because even though this is the final level, it still works the same as all the other ones. So we're going to start off by taking out Mothra before moving Godzilla into the battle. One of the funny things that ends up happening on this map, because of the way all the monsters are set up, sometimes a monster will activate to try to move, but since other ones are right in front of them, they're unable to move, so they end up not even moving at all. But because of the setup, as you can see, there's no way to skip any fights here. So every one of the kaiju, which of course now we have King Ghidorah to look forward to at the very end, we will have to fight everyone one more time here on Planet X, which I don't really mind Planet X because you get that nice little gauntlet against all the kaiju in the game. It's just the all the levels overall leading up to this point start to become a chore as you made it farther into the game, because so many times doing those same exact landscapes. Though, like I said earlier on in the video, I do like the blue landscape, color landscape to these style of levels. Once back at the map, we'll move over one more space to a volcano-style spot, and this will put us in line to face off against Ghidorah. These volcano levels, there's a few of those in this planet, so have to watch out for the volcanoes in the background and the like, but still pretty simple. By now, you're probably an absolute expert at all the level types and not all the enemies you've battled so far in the game. Here we go against Ghidorah one last time, hitting with that atomic breath. As you can see, we're able to get multiple atomic breaths off very fast now, and it regenerates pretty fast too. And we're going to do our jump attack punches and kicks and try to keep Ghidorah off the wall if at all possible, though sometimes it's unfortunate, but we're unable to do so. Anytime you're able to get that free opportunity though to hit an atomic breath, definitely use it. Sometimes it forces him a little bit back by doing it. Thank you. We're able to move a little bit closer and work our way through Planet X a bit as we go into another spaceship style of level. And we get the gear up for our last battle encounter against Mulgira. Get up close like always and stun lock the crap out of them. Usually you won't have to deal with really much, if anything at all. Even when there's blast hit you, they won't do much. If you've leveled up Godzilla up to level 16, which you should have by now, you will have no problem taking out this final fight against Mulgira, that is for sure. Now we're making it to the second half of the planet. We've made some distance here now on Planet X and started to get into really kind of like the battle royal of consistent encounters against the kaiju. Here's another one of those levels with all the towers and such. Atomic Breath, always our friend to kind of help us avoid some hits from the projectiles and be able to kind of mow down multiple of the cannon-like things in a row. Just be very careful. There's one guy who can still devastate you, but overall shouldn't be too bad to get through this. After our millionth space style level, we move one space closer to Smog Monster and go into this style level, the plant style of level, with the bean stalks and the like, and use that breath to hit the ones that kind of get in our way. We can use the breath to kind of go through a few of them, take out a few totem poles or whatever they're supposed to be, take those guys out, and just keep moving forward. Here we go with the battle against the Smog Monster. Just keep that distance a little bit away from the Smog hands as they're going to try to push towards you and try to hit you. Doing that duck will allow us to get hit but not usually knock us back with projectiles from the Smog Monster itself. And just keep hitting them with that tail. Now we get to move one step closer and get into another level, and we are right near Varen and Baragon. This is just another one of the space station style of levels. Nothing really special to see here, just more cannons and stuff like that, and kicking our way through. Just nothing really can stop Godzilla at this point. These guys are not going to really be able to do too much to you as you walk through these stages, just devastating everything in your path. We'll be right back.
For the fight of Varin, hit him with that atomic breath. Could you predict that? I don't know if you could potentially predict that. Never done that before any of the fights in this game. And then, of course, guess what we're doing next? I bet you didn't guess. We're going to just duck down and keep hitting him with our tail, try to keep him away from us, and slowly drain that health, and then hit him with more atomic breath when we get the opportunity to do so. Here we go with Baragon once again. Now, Baragon, like always, can put up a little bit of a fight just because sometimes it's hard to hit him with the breath, and he can kind of get close to you and munch on your lower region in order to kind of hit you a little bit, and especially get you stuck a lot, but still pretty simple to deal with. Unfortunately, Baragon, because of the fight itself and the way he ends up moving and such, I do have to do another battle. Like right here, I hit the atomic breath, but I do nothing against him because he stood up in the middle of it, and somehow that negates the breath altogether. It's weird how that ends up working, but either way, eventually, I'm able to kind of hit a solid breath and finish him off. Now, without even moving, Gigan comes up close, so we don't have to go after him. Watch out for that buzzsaw, but pretty much the same strats as always here apply for Gigan. Sometimes he will survive a round, though, so it may take you two rounds to finish him off, but still the same fight we've dealt with before. Now, one thing cool, the hyperspace level that we get to do here is actually one that features the giant ship, the Goten ship. We're going to use the atomic breath, though, to just kind of devastate and walk pretty much straight on through past it. But it is cool that that's another one of those things that kind of makes an appearance in the game. So that's pretty cool. Right after that, though, we're right into our fight against good old Mechagodzilla. Hitting him with that breath and the tail. He does have that bit of firepower. But it shouldn't be too much. The Ghidorah fight's the last thing that's really going to put up any kind of threat against us. Ghidorah is pretty challenging, the hardest of all of the kaiju to fight in the game, which of course he should be. But the fight against Mechagodzilla here shouldn't put up too much of a challenge. It just may last more than one round because of just how much health Mechagodzilla ends up having, of course. Now we move in closer, we move one step closer, and then we will have Ghidorah right after we do another one of these space levels. Thankfully, there's only one more level after this that we have to do, and it's pretty much identical to this one, as well as identical to the hundreds of other ones that are exactly the same that we've done throughout the game, but at least we have that shiny reward of fighting Ghidorah after we get through this. So here we go with the battle against King Ghidorah. Big, of course, giant sprite, three-headed monster here. Gonna hit him with that atomic breath. Now, he can get close to you, knock you into the corner, and destroy your health. If you get in the corner, jump attack. Like, just keep hitting jump, hold up on the D-pad, keep hitting that. The try to get out of the corner and get him back into a position where you can keep hitting him with the tail. Ghidorah does a lot of damage, there is no doubt about it, and can still devastate you. It's the only thing that can really put up a threat late in the game after you've already reached the higher levels of experience, but just kind of keep knocking him away, hit him with the breath. It may take you more than one round, especially with how much health Ghidorah has, but if he gets you in the corner at any point, just be prepared to kind of jump and just keep jump attacking, and hopefully you're able to knock him away if you get stuck in that corner against him. For the second round, though, I'm able to hit a couple of breaths right near the beginning, and that's enough to finish off King Ghidorah. The game isn't over yet, though. It's kind of anticlimactic at this point, but we can move on to the last spot, which is another one of these space station-esque style of stages. If for some reason you have Mothra, of course, still alive, you would have to get Mothra all the way through this, and if Mothra died, even though you've already killed Ghidorah, you've defeated every other kaiju in the game multiple times, and made Godzilla all the way through, but if Mothra had died after Godzilla escapes the planet, you would have to, you would get that game over and have to do everything over again. Now, even with Mothra dying in the level, she still appears in the game's ending. It's not really a spectacular ending for the amount of stuff you end up having to do in this game. You know, not a really shining ending, that is for sure. But, I mean, not the worst the NES has to offer either, but it's still, no matter what, even if Mothra dies a million times during the course of the game, she will still be there at the very end once we get through Planet X and beat Ghidorah and everything like that. When you make it to the end of the screen, you'll come back to the mat one last time, and then all you have to do is hit Occupy the Base, and sit back and enjoy the ending to Godzilla Monster of Monsters. So, there you have it, Godzilla Monster of Monsters. After the ending text scroll, you then get each of the kaiju introduced with their names, of course. You probably already know them by now because we've gone through the whole game and battled them so many times and seen their health bars and all that good stuff. Still, it's a game that I appreciate a bit more now with my knowledge of the series than I did when I was a kid. As a kid, I just found the game a bit too repetitive and was difficult because I didn't know all the tricks of you could lock so many of the monsters using the tail whip. I wish there was more variety overall to this game, as it's still one that I finally remember because of nostalgia and everything like that, but, you know, it's not the best Godzilla game. In fact, there really isn't that many amazing Godzilla games even throughout the course of gaming. And then when they went ahead and made a sequel, even though it's called Godzilla 2, it doesn't play anything like this game at all. Though I wouldn't have minded a sequel that was done that was similar but just added more variety and changed things up a little bit. But either way, guys, that's going to wrap up this episode of Play It Through. Hey everyone, thanks for watching. If you enjoyed the video, consider giving it a thumbs up or commenting down below. If you enjoyed this playthrough, be sure to check out one of the recent ones I did for the Ninja on the Sega Master System. Or for something a little bit different, I recently counted down my top 10 favorite NES sports titles. I of course also need to thank all the members of my Patreon. Without your guys' support, I wouldn't be able to keep doing what I'm doing, so thank you all so, so much. In fact, this playthrough was a Patreon donated for Play It Through, so if you'd like to help out, maybe get a Play It Through that you've always wanted done, just click that little Patreon button. It has all the details. But anyway, guys, thank you so much for all that support, watching this video, and of course, I hope you enjoyed.